scholarly outline. You've seen the annotated bibliography. You've seen how to go into the library databases, find your articles, and then copy and paste your citations and take some notes about those articles to support your main points. Now you're going to pull this all together in an outline. Your outline, you've already done an outline. And as you can see here, the outline doesn't change in terms of its format. You still have, as you can see, Roman numeral. You have introduction. You have proper spacing here. An A, a B, a C, a 1, a 2, a 3, and those need periods by them. You also have your thesis statement is a full sentence in only one sentence. You have your action verbs, short phrases. You have your full transition statements and your full sentences for your main points. So you learned that in your partner speech, and you can see that in this case, a scholarly outline has some consistency to it. Okay, even in the setup of it, you're starting off with your header, the class COM 130 in your case, and your name there, COM 130, Dr. Porter. Then you're going to put outline and you're going to put your topic there, just as you did with your annotated bibliography. You're going to put introduction and then opening story. Again, what you're going to notice here on the outline is you don't see the opening story typed out here. You are going to start with an opening story. In the partner speeches, you started with a 1 minute me video. That set the scene. It told the audience what you were doing. You had introduced yourself. You told them you were going to talk about the three sides of self. You previewed your main points. And then you went to the 1 minute me, which is a video montage introducing your topic. In this case, you're going to introduce your topic with an opening story. And in that opening story, you're going to follow what you follow on your evaluation rubric, and you're going to let the audience know who you are, why you're interested in this topic. You're going to answer the question, why me, why this topic? So when I start out, I'm going to tell the audience, hi, I'm Laurie Porter. Thank you for allowing me to talk to you today about how to become a successful HBCU legacy. I'd like to start off with an opening story of my first day on campus and what I learned about the difference, the HBCU factor. You'll start off there, and that's about 1 minute. And every good introduction, I want you to watch on the playlist. There's a video saying how to do a good introduction. You've heard me talk many times about the value of stories, examples. You're going to start that off. The audience needs to know, why are you talking about HBCU legacies? Why are you talking about diabetes? Why are you talking about police brutality? Why are you talking about food deserts and the impact on college students? There's just a gamut of topics. But in that, you're going to have to narrow down a good story that frames that topic. You're going to give a personal human face to it. And in your outline, you're simply going to put your Roman numeral to the left here. And you're going to put introduction. You're going to type that. And you're going to put opening story. You can unpack that in any way you want for your speech, but you're going to type it just like this. B is always going to be stating your thesis. We have talked about this as well. Thesis statement is one sentence long. If this was an informative speech, then I can say how to become a successful HBCU legacy. In this case, it can be a persuasive speech. I will become a successful HBCU legacy, and I'm going to defend that. Your outline does not change whether it is an informative or a persuasive speech. Both have persuasive elements to it. If I'm going to discuss with you how to become a successful HBCU legacy, it implies that I'm defending that an HBCU is a worthy education and that this, in fact, is believable and credible. So you're going to set up state thesis colon just as I did. You're going to type that, and you're going to type your one sentence thesis statement. For the informative speech, you're not limited to any topics. You may put marijuana should be legalized in the state of North Carolina, and go on to defend that in a logical, well-supported way based on main points. You may say police brutality has caused insecurity in the African American communities. Then you're going to go on and preview how you're going to tackle this big subject that you chose. You're going to, in some way, be passionate about it, connected to that subject, but you're going to have to break it down, just as you did in your partner speeches, in 2 to 3 main categories. It's a large subject. It's your opinion. It's your framing of this information. And you have to assume, too, you can't just break down something like bullying is wrong. Everyone knows bullying is wrong. You must take the topic and say bullying has an increased impact on college campuses, or an increased impact for young people. And you'll have to defend that it's increasing across the web, and how. And you have to assume, too, that your audience knows a little something. You can't simply say, here, discuss physical bullying, mental bullying, cyberbullying, and define those. That's not enough. You cannot just do simple explanations here. I'm going to discuss here who HBCUs are. I'm going to discuss some research about student success, because again, I'm required to integrate voices other than my own. But then I can include, as one of my main points, my own personal experience. So I've imparted upon you the relevance of picking a good topic. Pick something that you're connected to. Pick something that doing the research is actually interesting to you, but that you already have some form of connection to that topic. So here I clearly tell the audience where I'm going, that I'm going to discuss HBCUs, I'm going to discuss research about student success, and I'm going to discuss my choice and plan. I'm going to do, again, a transition statement. You see how it's in parentheses here? Just as your parents, and I'm missing a parent at the end there, your parentheses, transition statements had a colon in your partner speeches, same thing. People often do not understand HBCUs and their students. I said in my main point one, I was going to discuss HBCUs and who we are. One common mistake is that people will preview main points and then not actually follow them. Whatever I say are going to be my main points here, here, and here, you must see them here, here, and then again on your third point. They should match. So as you see, for main point number two, I am going to discuss research about HBCU student success. Your main point here should clearly state research provides insight for success at an HBCU. Again, you see that the preview of your main points matches your main points. And again, you have to follow the normal rules of outlining. For every A, there must be a B. Okay? For every 1, there's a 2. Your Roman numerals are lined up flush left here, okay? Your A's and B's are also lined up here, okay? And you also notice underneath each, you have a short action verb and then a short phrase. That's exactly what you did in your partner speeches. You're not typing out long sentences, and you're not starting them with nouns. Discuss, define, provide. You will continue with that pattern. I discussed in the bibliography, in the annotated bibliography, that I gave you sources with 1 author, 2 authors, and more than 2 authors. to give you an example of how to do what we call in-source citations. An in-source citation is this. Okay. As you can see, and I made a mistake here, this should all be in parentheses here and a semicolon right here between these two. Again, if you did it like me, I wouldn't count off, but you want your parentheses, okay? And you want Love, 2009, McCoy and McKay. And again, these should have a semicolon between if you have more than one source at the end of this. I just put two parens there. But what you can see here is that Crawford, 2012. McCoy and McKay, 2006. That has two authors. Crawford had one. Okay. Nasum is interesting because Nasum, anything that has more than two authors and does not look like one author, two authors, if it is not that, any more than two, you must cite the source like Nasum. Nasum here has, I think that had four authors. Anything more than two, you'll put Nasum et al. E-T-A-L, you see the dot here and the comma and the date. Any source that you have that has two looks like McCoy and McKay, 2006, anything over two looks like Nasum et al. And you'll just put the first, the last name of the first author. And authors are in order of their relevance. So they're not in alphabetical order. So as you noticed from the annotated bib, Nasum was listed and then the next author, you just put Nasum. That's all you need to put. You notice too that you're not putting their first names after their last. These are their last names. And then you put your et al. And then the date. That's how you do any source that has more than two authors. Again, two authors looks like that, and one author looks like that. So the reason I did this is a cheat sheet for you. So what these sources, what this is doing here is right here, I'm going to discuss why students choose HBCUs because of the campus climate, and I'm going to unpack that. You saw in my annotated bib how I was going to use that because I'm telling you about the value of an HBCU education here, and I want to cite that according to Crawford in 2012, campus climate was one of the primary reasons that students choose an HBCU, and that actually Crawford and in 2012 found that the surrounding campus climate and having a supportive environment gave you an advantage at an HBCU that you did not have at PWIs and did translate to better grades, academic success, and retention. So that's how I would discuss that when I'm speaking to the audience. I will verbally state these sources and I'll unpack them. For the purposes of your outline, you just want it to look like this. I am simply noting that this is what I'm going to discuss. You may unpack it and type it out in any way that you want for your cheat sheet and for your notes that you hold that your audience doesn't see, or the notes that you use to prepare over and over again so that you have a smooth delivery. But in your outline, all you are putting is your action verbs and your short phrases. And if it had research associated that you were going to discuss, then you're going to put that author there. Or in this case, if you're going to discuss academic self-concept, which involved two of my groupings here, McCoy and McKay and Nasum, then I would put a semicolon between those two. I'd put them just as they're listed. I just happen to put two parens side by side. But I would discuss those, and I would start off by saying, let me discuss some research on self-concept and self-efficacy research. And I'd like to start with McCoy and McKay. McCoy and McKay in 2006 found, and I would discuss that with the audience. Then I would say second, Nasum and Associates. I could say Nasum et al. If I wanted to. It sounds a little pretentious, but I would say Nasum and colleagues in 2005 found that X, and I would tell how storytelling and a positive view of oneself and affirmation in a public environment outside of the normal schooling help students to do better in school. So you see how I would unpack my outline verbally, and this is how my outline is going to look. I'm going to always put my transition statements in parentheses and a full sentence. And in this case, in addition to, I'm reminding the audience where I was and where I'm going. Okay? And then I'm going to discuss my plan and why I chose it. Why am I going to do that? Because I told the audience up here that that's what I was going to do. I was going to, in my third point, discuss my plan. So I want to proceed to do the things that I tell the audience that I'm going to do. So we're going to end the outline with our conclusion, and I need a period right here in my V, okay? And you're going to do your Roman numeral 5 and conclusion. You're going to type that word because every single speech is going to have a conclusion. You're going to have an A and a B. Again, I need my periods there. Restate thesis and summarize main point. End with Mandela quote about the man in the arena. You're going to do exactly as you did in your partner speeches. In your conclusion, you're going to restate your thesis. You're going to remind the audience what your three main points were. I will become a successful HBCU legacy. I discussed HBCUs and who we are as students. I discussed research about HBCU student success. And I discussed my HBCU choice and plan for success. So as you can see in my conclusion, I restated my thesis and I summarized my main points. Then I want to leave them something to think about. In the end, I'd like to leave you with a quote from Nelson Mandela about the man in the arena. And it goes like this, and I would quote that. Okay, you want to think of some phrase, saying, summary that leaves the audience with something to think about. You have already noted in your outline here, you have noted all of your sources. You've spoken them into existence in your in-source citations. Okay, you have included research. You've opened up with a story, you have transitioned, and now at the very bottom, these sources are going to appear again. Now, as you can see, these sources are copied and pasted. They look exactly as they did in my annotated bibliography, and you're going to notice that they're in alphabetical order at the bottom. They are not in the order that they appeared. That's not how they go. They go in alphabetical order, and if you spoke about them and you put them in parentheses up there in the speech, which you have to do, you have to show where you're going to use it. You can't just copy and paste 5 sources at the end. They need to be the same sources that you had on your annotated bibliography, and they need to be at the bottom of the outline. As you'll notice here, I do not have all the annotation. I do not have all those paragraphs that I had over in my annotated bibliography. I simply have the sources listed at the bottom of the outline. I do, however, still have the formatting. See that reverse indent? See Crawford and all the authors are flush left, but then all the second lines are 5 spaces in. If you lose any of your spacing when you go to the outline, just make sure that you insert that again. So I mentioned all my sources up here. I spoke about them in my speech, and then I copied and pasted them in alphabetical order at the bottom. Everyone will do an outline. It outlines, it's your map. It is the way that it keeps your audience the exact same way that you appreciated in partner speeches, is the exact momentum and orderly fashion that audiences demand for an informative or persuasive speech. They want to know, start off with a human face. You're going to relate the topic to them and to your interest in it, your credibility around it. You're going to state very succinctly your thesis statement. You're going to tell them the way that you're going to support that, be it an informative topic or a persuasive. And again, I'm going to give you a lot of leeway in that because I believe there is very little difference between informing me and persuading me. Because if I'm going to inform you about becoming an HBCU legacy or the benefits of an HBCU legacy or that I will become one, I'm both informing you and persuading you. So in essence, what I'm saying here is that when you learn this outline, just as you did for the partner speeches, it is an advantage to you because it's an academic outline. It's the same process you will follow every time you go to give a professional presentation, a public speech. It's also the process that you will follow in writing a good essay. Every good essay starts off with that big first opening paragraph that sets the scene, and at the bottom of that paragraph is your thesis statement. And you can even preview in that your three main points, where you're going to go. So think about also in this balance. Every main point has something in it. I suggested in one of my talks that you put a resource or a scholarly source in each main point. You can do that or you don't have to do that. You can put, as you can see here, I have Crawford in my main point one, and I have three of my sources in main point two. I just want to, predominantly in my main point one, I only have one scholarly source because I'm also going to paint a picture of the definition and history of an HBCU, and in this case, I was going to use JCSU's history. So you just need to have the three sources in there. You could choose, some students have chosen to put in each main point, the first main point discuss the research, the second main point discuss their personal experience around that, their interpretation of that. That's also another organizing principle that you can use. But it's a very simple concept. If you break it down, you break it down into bite-sized pieces, and you can't cover everything in a topic, but this is a great way to keep you on track for a 5 to 7 minute speech. And again, use the eyeball test. If your outline does not look like this, then it's not right. So I want to show you before we close a sample of an incorrect scholarly outline. If we're actually using the eyeball test, as you can see on this introduction, being a successful college student athlete, they have the Roman numeral 1 and the A. But as you can see, they've gone completely rogue here. They have gone sentences and all kinds of research. Doesn't say introduction. It does not open with a story, which right here I should just say opening story. That's what should be typed here. If this is the opening story, it should be opening story. And then B, here's my thesis. I will become a successful college student athlete. Okay, in this case, I have three main points, and it says graduation rates, no action verb. It should be discuss. Okay, here, I could put discuss. And then here, how did students prepare themselves? Again, it starts off with a noun, and then expectations. You need your action verbs and short phrases to tell the audience what these main points are. And on main points, you can actually give more extended sentences. Now, the graduation rates of student athletes have increased over time through HBCUs. You could have put up here in the main point, discuss the graduation rates of student, the increase in graduation rates of student athletes or discuss research on, and then make sure that these two look exactly the same. Okay. Now, main point two says, how did students prepare themselves for success while in college? Okay. That's your main point two. Right here, on their main point two, it says college students have different goals for themselves. Each person has a different style of accomplishing their goals in the classroom and out. I'm not sure how that relates to that, and I really shouldn't have to guess. Main point two needs to look exactly like that. So I might put in my preview of main points up here, this. College students discuss the varying goals college students have, or discuss diverse styles of accomplishing goals in the classrooms. Then these two would match and they would be just right. Okay. So as you can see, I need to match my main points with their main points. I need to avoid any narrative, long paragraphs. I need to use my action verbs and short phrases. And I also notice here there's transition statements are missing. You know, all of those transitions in parens, they're all missing here. I haven't told my audience, now that I've discussed graduation rates of student athletes, and where do they go? They go exactly where they were in the sample outline that I gave you. So the eyeball test would have helped this student a lot. They would have first looked at it and said, well, mine looks very different from hers. Now I'm going to hit on a final point here. I have sources here. And the thing that I like here is that I notice that these are ProQuest sources, which is the database that I told you to use. And I notice that they're put in the right format. Actually, they've used italics all the way, which it shouldn't be italicized. They should just have them straight, and the only italics should be the title. But just follow that. I would not be insane about that. But everything else is just right. And I also noticed that they all came from the ProQuest and for journals that are scholarly sources. Okay, so the student has done that correctly. But what the student has failed to do is put that information up here at all. There are, if I list here that Harvard is one of my sources in 2012, and as you notice, there's four authors, so it would be Harvard et al. 2012. Or in this case, I have Hines, Borders, and Gonzalez. That would also be Hines et al. 2015. I should see that. And I have two sources here, Rutan and Walker 2015. That should appear as Rutan and Walker 2015 because I've counted. If I have one author, then it looks one way. If I have two authors, it looks another way, like McCoy and McKay in my sample. Or if I have three authors, it's your first author and your et al. And the date. What I am missing in this outline all the way around are all these sources. They're not mentioned. The student may have taken some information from that, but they haven't cited it in any way. So biggest problem I have is plagiarism. I have to mention them where they're supposed to be. So if I'm going to discuss Harvard et al. To all stats, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to type at the end of my action verb discuss, okay, and that I'm going to put in parens, Harvard. This is kind of hard to do with just, you know, writing it out. Et al. I'd be typing this. And I'd put the date, whatever that date was, down there. Okay? I'd put it right there inside the outline. And so my point here is go back to your eyeball test. Every source that's at the bottom here must be listed in parentheses up here in the place where you spoke about it. Obviously, you're speaking about this source. You summarized it in a usable, workable way, and you've also translated it for the audience. What this means to me is X. If this student is talking about higher graduation rates of student athletes, which actually I've seen this speech done a few different ways, and it's an excellent, these stats were great stats. The person was actually proving that the person has less chances of going to the NFL, but they have more chances of graduating from college than most students. And he found that as a student athlete to be profoundly important, and he unpacked that for the audience. So the main thing here is, and this, I don't believe this was the same student in this case, but what I can see from this student is that they have done their research. They have not put it together in the correct format, and then it's possibly in the delivery going to be a train wreck, and it's not going to have also cited those sources verbally either. So you're going to put together, do your eyeball test, make sure your outline looks right, and that helps you to also follow along and to cite those sources along the way. It allows you to know exactly where you're going to speak about Crawford's research or McCoy and McKay or Nasum and Associates, etc. So just make sure that you go back to your samples that are provided that help you to do an orderly process.